It first started in 1967 when I found out that I had not gotten the big picture, even though I thought that I had it together. I just didn't have the complete pieces of the picture. This is a giant geo-psycho-political picture, and things are happening with the use of subliminal, indirect, and reverse psychological propaganda. It's made to be confusing by the evilarchy that controls not only the United States, but Britain. This Illuminati, this group who called themselves the Enlightened Ones, had gained positions of power through control of the banking system.
The very heart and core of all these secret societies lurks the Kabbalah. It is a method of encoding information through a system of mathematics and numbers. These people that belong to the secret societies never dared to write down in any language what they knew, what it was that they were guarding, because then someone could steal it and then the secret would be out. So they took this knowledge and they made it occult through a system of encoding encryption, one of which is mathematics, numbers. Another is architecture. Anybody wonder why do they have a fraternal organization called the Freemasons? Aren't those the guys that build walls? You bet they do. But every wall they build contains the secrets that have been kept and maintained throughout the ages, and it's encoded in the architecture and in the measurements of the buildings and in the mathematical formulas used to derive the geometry, the shape, the length and breadth and height of rooms. All encoded there.
And I get people who still come to me all the time and say, Bill, you're all wrong. It's the Jews. The Jews are subverting the world. Man, it's not the Jews. It's not the Catholics. It's not the blacks. It's these men who belong to the ancient mystery schools who meet in secret and decide the fate of the world. And they belong to all different races and all different nationalities and all different religions to the public point of view. But in secret, it's a different story.
The point I'm getting at is that because we're all pounded with so much intellectual property that has no basis in sensory reality, there's no life form that embodies Christianity, that embodies the intellectual property of the Bible, that embodies the intellectual property of the Talmud or the Torah or the Gitas or Buddhism or gravity or, you know, all official science or all the courses in Cruising Universe. Just basically we are saturated by intellectual property that has no basis in fact, in reality. So if you think about that and the conflict that so many of us have different forms of intellectual property that we're representing, and we start arguing and fighting for this intellectual property, we have chaos. So then we need order. So the order is provided by the people who conned us into believing in this information, so we give our power away to them. So hence, which we said in some of the other videos, we believe in this God that's remote from us, and they have authorized representatives representing this God. We can acquiesce by giving our power away because we believe the story that was sold to us, right? Because the story, the background is so convincing that we'll give up our responsibility for who we are for these representatives who then have all the power because we acquiesced our lives to them. And that is really what I think is going on, and that is the true scam of science. It's the scam of basically
almost everything of the system.
And this is also the scam that's coming down now with the alien invasion, with the Galactic Federation, and everything else going on, because by putting those images in our brain, we are the ones creating, because we're projecting that information. So by manipulating us, as we said in the first beginning of part one, you know, if they can get you to think and feel what they want you to think, and get you to put your energy, your life force energy into those thoughts, into those images, you will create that world, their world. Slaves will only create a world in their master's image without realizing.
It's like if we tell our children often enough that they're bad and stupid, they'll end up creating a world of them being bad and stupid.
Yeah, and science,
believing they're bad and stupid.
And science is just an intellectual property, no different than anything else. You put your energy into that, and you've been pounded with it. You could possibly believe it, and you could be superimposing all that information over what really does exist, and over the purpose of everything. To the point that we disconnect from it, so we don't know what the true purpose of everything is anymore in the real world. And now we're living for the purpose that is the commerce, that's the idea of having, we must go to school and go to university so we can have titles, and we have to accept that the man who now acts as a police officer, that his title as a policeman and the statutes that he's enforcing puts him onto a higher standing than another man. Now again, we've explained some of this in part one to part three and part four of The Dream of Life. But can you see what I'm saying? You can see the elements of this kind of psychological terrorist attack on all of us to deceive us into falling for this kind of stuff. when we challenge scientists, astronauts, and we have spoken to NASA astronauts, some of who are quite known, and we've spoken to experts in many fields of endeavor, and we challenge them to bring forward proof of their claim to back their claims, first party to first party, as in what I said before. Where is the ancestors of gravity? Where's the ancestors of evolution? Where do their children play? What do they do for life that aids life from rolling along? Whatever it is they're espousing.
How can we sense it?
How can we sense it? Yeah, what is its purpose? What you find is just a man and woman representing this intellectual property, because this intellectual property does not have a life form to embody it. So they have to represent it, which then means we have to give up our uniqueness. We have to be hijacked to become in their image. And that goes back to what I was saying.
Well, I would just say then really what we would like to do is offer, offer a challenge. We stand for freedom of thought and freedom of speech and all that sort of stuff. So obviously if anyone wants to believe in science or religion, that's totally their choice. However, if they are sincere in wanting to know the truth, then it's really good to look at everything you've learned and be prepared to look at it from different viewpoints.
Scrutinize it.
How does it work? How does it fit in? Because so many times, if people believe in something really strongly, there comes a point where they say they are open-minded and they're willing to debate and discuss, but there comes a point when they just won't consider anything that does not fit in with their belief system.
Yes.
Now that's fine if that's how you want to think and feel, but it will not get you to the truth.
Today, Queen Elizabeth II is the head of state of the great nation of the Hebrew Covenant called Great Britain. Her genealogy chart, according to the College of Heralds in London, traces her blue bloodline back to Abraham, who many modern scholars believe to be the Egyptian pharaoh, Amenemhat I. By connecting 22 dots, the true Hebrew and royal Egyptian identity of Queen Elizabeth II comes into focus. Number one. What is the Stone of Jacob, a Hebrew patriarch, doing beneath the Queen's throne chair? Number two, why was the Queen crowned at her coronation ceremony on top of a symbolic Egyptian step pyramid? Number three, the monarch's crown has 12 stones at the base, each representing the 12 Hebrew tribes. The 12 stones of the 12 tribes were also worn on the breastplate of Hebrew high priests in Canaan. Number four, the Union Jack represents the reunion of the United Kingdom of the 12 tribes of Jacob, or Jack-ub. The Union Jack is red, white, and blue, the same colors as the three crowns of Egypt. Number five, the royal scepter originates in ancient Egypt and was carried by the Egyptian god Amun and by Egyptian pharaohs, who called themselves the Son of God. The royal scepter is now carried by pharaonic descendant Queen Elizabeth II. Her scepter contains the world's largest cut diamond, called the Star of Africa. Number six, the Queen's punishing flail or whip is partially hidden under her arm. The flail or whip also originates with the pharaohs of ancient Egypt. Number seven, the symbol of the bee can be found within the Queen's royal wardrobe. In ancient Egypt, bees were the symbol of Egyptian royalty as well as the symbol of Egypt. Number eight, the symbols on the British coat of arms reveal Britain's Hebrew origin. According to the Bible, the harp symbolizes the Hebrew King David. The biblical lion and unicorn holding up the shield symbolize the nation of Israel. The motto, Dieu et mon droit, means God and my right, indicating the divine right of the British monarch to an eternal throne. Number nine, the headdress worn by judges and the Queen's high-ranking officials originate in ancient Egypt. Number 10, kilts like the one worn by Prince Charles originate with the Egyptian pharaohs who wore white kilts. Number 11, the hymn Zadok the Priest, written by Handel, was performed at the Queen's coronation in 1952. Zadok the Priest was the biblical priest who anointed the Hebrew King Solomon while the people cried, God save King Solomon, long live King Solomon, may the king live forever.
God save Queen Elizabeth. Long live Queen Elizabeth. May the Queen live forever.
Number 12. During the coronation ceremony, the Queen turns to face the four corners of the globe. The orb carried by the Queen represents the globe over which the monarch rules. Number 13, the monarch's coronation gifts of a rod, bracelets, and a ring are a reenactment of the Bible story of the Hebrews, Judah, and Tamar. Number 14, royal jubilees originate in ancient Egypt. Egyptian pharaohs celebrated their jubilees after 30 years of rule. In pharaonic tradition, the queen has celebrated both silver and golden jubilees. Number 15, incest was practiced by ancient Egyptian royalty. Mothers married sons and brothers married sisters to keep the power and the money all in the family. Like their pharaonic ancestors, the British monarchy have a long history of incestuous inbreeding. Number 16, the corpses of deceased pharaohs were preserved and entombed beneath their pyramid temples. The corpses of 19 deceased British monarchs are also preserved in marble tomb slabs beneath the modern-day temple called Westminster Abbey. Number 17, the ancient pharaohs advertised their power with their image on coins and stone monuments. The power of the queen worldwide is advertised with her image printed on more coins and stamps than any other head of state in history. Number 18, the structure of government in ancient Egypt was a step pyramid model, with the Grand Vizier and priesthood one step below the pharaoh. Today's monarchy reigns using a much more sophisticated pyramid model of authority. Number 19. The Pope's headdress is strikingly similar to the headdress of the Egyptian god Amun. His bent cross resembles the scepter of Amun. Number 20. Like the Egyptian pharaohs, British monarchs wear signet rings, which over the millennia have been passed down from their Hebrew ancestors. Number 21. The British Mint recently printed legal tender coins called the One True Ring and the Ring of Power. On one side of the coin is Queen Elizabeth II. On the flip side is the ring from Lord of the Rings. These legal tender coins printed by the British Mint raise the disturbing question, who is the real Lord of the Rings?
One ring to rule them all.
The inscription on the ring reads, one ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the darkness of their ignorance, bind them. Number 22, the covenant that the biblical God gave to Abraham was a promise to make his name great and to make for him a great nation. Today, Great Britain is the only nation called great. In Hebrew, the word Britain literally means land of the covenant, and British means man of the covenant. How on earth did the Hebrew throne of ancient Egypt and Canaan end up in Great Britain under Queen Elizabeth II? Historically, a series of powerful invaders, the Philistines, Assyrians, Babylonians, and Persians, conquered the land of Canaan, which the Hebrews called Israel. The Hebrew tribes of Manasseh and Dan joined forces and became the Macedonians, or Macedonians. They fled to Greece with their gold and their riches. They wore white kilts like the Egyptian pharaohs, played goatskin bagpipes, adopted the Greek culture, and settled along the river Danube, which they named after the tribe of Dan. By 322 BC, their leader, Alexander the Great, reconquered Egypt and appointed his general, Ptolemy I, as the new Hebrew pharaoh of Egypt. Cleopatra was the last in a succession of Hebrew Ptolemy kings. Although Cleopatra is considered to be the last of the Egyptian pharaohs, author Ralph Ellis claims that Jesus was the last of the Hebrew pharaohs of Egypt. Jesus, a pharaoh? How is that possible? The historical facts show that the last pharaoh of Egypt was Ptolemy the 15th, who was nicknamed Caesarion, or Little Caesar. Born in 47 BC, Caesarion was the son of two of the most famous parents in world history, Roman ruler Julius Caesar and Egyptian pharaoh Cleopatra. When Caesarion's mother, Cleopatra, proclaimed herself to be the reincarnation of the virgin goddess Isis, Caesarion became the son of a virgin mother goddess. When Caesarion's father, Julius Caesar, was elevated to the status of god by the Roman Senate, Caesarion was recognized as the son of God and heir to God's kingdom, the Roman Empire. But there is a more scientific explanation for their madness. For thousands of years, these families have practiced inbreeding between sisters and brothers, uncles and nieces, mothers and sons, to keep the power and wealth all in the family. This practice of inbreeding over thousands of years has produced a clever but pathological breed of conscienceless, sociopathic families who will stop at nothing to own every ounce of gold, every drop of water, and every blade of grass on planet Earth. The United Nations, which they founded and control, has clearly stated its goals of establishing a new world order, a UN standing army, and a global taxation system. The Queen's husband, Prince Philip, and Evelyn Rothschild have already established an interfaith declaration for the creation of one world religion. What would life be like in this world empire with one world religion, one world army, one world economy, one world court, one world media, one world government, and one world dictator? What the public doesn't know is that Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto and the Russian Constitution have been built into the UN Charter, and that the New World Order will be a communist world order. Peace on Earth will be a forced peace in which citizens will have no rights. No right to bear children without approval, no right to travel without authorization, no right to own private property, no right to privacy, no right to bear arms, no right to protest, no right to receive an inheritance, no right to choose an education or a job or even a place of residence, and worst of all, no right to live. The right to live will be based on an individual's rating of usefulness to the royal elite. In this planned world without borders or nations, citizens will be disarmed of all weapons, including handguns, and will have no means to protest, fight, resist, or challenge this one world authority who will control them spiritually, economically, and militarily. Every human being will be electronically tattooed and will become helplessly dependent on this one world authority for all of their most basic needs. The masses will eventually be taught to bow down and worship this one world dictator who will rule the entire world from his eternal throne in Israel. The big question is, who is this charismatic leader that the entire world would be willing to accept as their ruler? According to plan, this future world ruler will prove himself to be a descendant of Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene, and will therefore be accepted by the Christian world. Some will even view him as the Savior and Messiah. As a professed descendant of Christ and a proponent of world religion, he will also be accepted by Buddhists, Hindus, and the Eastern world, where Jesus Christ reportedly lived, studied and preached Eastern philosophy. Since he is a descendant of the Hebrew tribes of Israel, he will also be accepted by Hebrews and Jews worldwide. By marrying a Muslim woman, he will win the acceptance of the Muslim world. He will also be accepted by worldwide Freemasonry and secret societies, which he is a member of. As the son of Princess Diana, he is already loved and worshipped. When his mother died in the arms of a Muslim man in a Paris car crash, the world embraced him. On May 31, 2004, the Rothschild-controlled Associated Press published a photograph worldwide taken by Alistair Grant. The photo shows Prince William posing with a lamb like Jesus Christ, who the Bible calls the Lamb of God. What is the significance of this photograph? To the unaware observer, the photograph is perfectly innocent, but to insiders familiar with the protocols of Zion, Freemasonry, and the Book of Revelations, William is identified in the photo as the Antichrist. The Antichrist has been described in art and literature as handsome and charming and a master of lies and deception. Freemasons call him the Baphomet, or Goat of Mendes. He has also been described as the embodiment of evil and the enemy of God, and has been called Satan, Lucifer, Pan, the Beast, and Amun. He is commonly illustrated with cloven hind hooves. Why is Prince William holding up a cloven hind hoof in the photograph? The question of whether God or Satan even exist has been fiercely debated since the beginning of debates. Some people believe that God and Satan are inventions of the ruling class to control the masses. Most people acknowledge the existence of positive creative energy characterized by joy, love, and vitality, and the existence of negative destructive energy characterized by greed, hatred, and death. The triumph of evil in the world today is based on the ability of evil to disguise itself as its opposite and fool the masses. According to Masonic calculations, Prince William is predicted to be crowned world dictator in the year 2015 at the age of 33. Without organized intervention, life and peace on earth will take on a whole new meaning.
If you want to find out what the truth is, and if you are sincere in trying to create a better world than the one we've got, you have to be prepared to pull apart everything you're thinking and take a look at it. Perhaps you're right. That's great. Then you'll be able to go, oh, I've pulled it all apart, examined it totally, scrutinized it from all possible angles, considered everyone else's viewpoints.
And had direct perception, direct experience.
Of all this, then I'm right, and that's great. Mm. But if you're not prepared to totally examine everything, then you're never going to find truth. And that's one of the things that we have done all the way along from when we started out trying to find remedy to bank fraud was, you know, somebody would come along and be like, oh, great, this is really, really, yeah. We'd be all for it. And then suddenly there would be things that didn't work or didn't seem logical, didn't fit in or just didn't make sense. And then we realize it was out with that one. Something else comes along. We're like, but we take the interesting bits from it. And then the next thing comes along. Oh, this is great. Fantastic. Same. Oh, suddenly we find bits don't work. Bits aren't logical. Don't make sense. Throw all the garbage. Keep again any little useful gems. There are useful gems everywhere. keep the gems, and then we just keep moving forward like that. Let go of all the lies. But let go of all the garbage that you find and stuff, and just keep the gems.
Well, can I just point out for you, I actually don't think it is fine that you have that belief, because what happens if the belief is a lie, and you're putting energy into the lie, and you're spreading that lie to other children who are also innocent, you're actually spreading destruction to who we are. Now, the thing is that if you have a whole wall that holds back the world of lies, and there's a tiny crack in the wall, and that's because of one lie, that one lie will allow the seepage of more lies to come through the wall until eventually it's worn that wall away, and the whole ocean of lies that's been held back will smash through that wall and enter amongst us, and will be saturated by a world of lies. And that lie, and all those lies lead us to harm, lead us to acquiesce our responsibilities to lie, lead us to give up our uniqueness, and will give us a false world. And that's what I think is what's happened
to us
today.
And I guess so what I should have said was, we're not suggesting that anybody just believes everything we're saying. We're just saying, just have a look at everything that you're believing and see what it's doing to create a world of peace, joy, happiness, abundance, do no harm, truth, all those things.
And don't you think, you know, really that is the priority, that we actually can create, with what we're thinking, a world that does no harm to anything living, no matter what, and provides all men, women, children, all living things with freedom, truth, joy, abundance, and without giving up our uniqueness, and without having to need slaves and rulers. Don't you think that would be a paradise world that we actually could create? Because I guess the reason why we're having such difficulty having that is because all the information coming at us from every possible direction are coming out of the Freemasonic Satanic world. Because if you look at this, up until 1780 AD, roughly, which is what we've been uncovering through other good people who've come into our lives providing us with their gems, and yes, we've discarded other information that just didn't feel right to us, didn't seem to be logical or practical. But if you look at this, up until 1780 AD, 99.99% of the total population of man all across Earth could not read and write any alphabet language. That means that today's supposed 6.7 billion population, all their ancestors going back through all recorded history, no matter how far it goes back in the records, they had nothing to do with recording it, because they couldn't read and write to be able to record it in any alphabet language.
So it was only a very few people who wrote down what we accept as being our true history.
Exactly, and they're roughly...
There were billions or millions of people living... They probably weren't even connected to those people writing the history.
Roughly 20 per 1 minute if anyone's recorded all the history, and they are, and none of us were there at the time when those events occurred. How do we know that the victors didn't twist the history or change it to suit their own agendas? No different to the way lies are peddled today to suit their own agenda, because they have a certain, the lie has a purpose. There's a reason for the lie. There's a purpose behind it. And when we recognize the lie, in the fact that it has an effect on us giving up responsibility for our lives and making us become disconnected from everything that we are part of, so we don't longer have a purpose, it's easy for us to be given an artificial purpose and follow that and think that we're on the true path. So I would say to everyone that to think seriously about all the information you are delving into that's history-based, no matter what it is, that who wrote it? Because roughly 20 per 1 minute wrote it. All across history, the only ones who could read and write any alphabet language, including hieroglyphics and all the alphabet language up until now. Were the owners of the castles, were the high priesthoods, were the landlords, the barons, the aristocrats, the high priesthoods, the royal families, and all their scribes and lackeys, right? They're the only ones who could read and write. Everyone else couldn't, because they had the village tribal talk, which was the song of life, which was formed from the sensations of nature all around them. And, you know, it took 20 years to master the craft of any alphabet language, and you had to be invited in. It's only been recent times all this has changed, which has become through English. It's been standardised, but it came with exclusivity and privilege to learn an alphabet language. And when you learned, you also had to learn mathematics and geometry, which is the basis of all science. So if you look at up to 1930 AD, even up to 1930 AD, still over 90% of the population of man across Earth could not read and write. So who wrote everything? Who wrote all the history? Who twisted everything? Because you can't trust what they're telling you, because you weren't there. And they weren't there. Who was there? Because everything is all based on third parties. So we've got to use logic and use scrutiny and scrutinize and look for the purpose of everything and see what is the purpose of whatever that intellectual property is. Does it have a purpose? For instance, we know what the purpose of a tree is because we can see it is part of we call now an ecosystem. And we know that the birds have a relationship with the tree, that the rain and the clouds have a relationship with the tree.
We can see the shade it gives
all the bugs, all the bark that comes off and breaks down from the tree and it starts to rot in the ground. It has a purpose to everything that's growing in that. So you can see this incredible relationship. But what about the intellectual property of official science? What about the intellectual property of all our history? What purpose does it have in the scheme of life today? What if all that information was to just set us off as slaves because we have believed we've come out of the Dark Ages, we've come out of being squidgy tiny things that came out of the water, and through the Neanderthal process through the apes and to become the man we are today, right? And we've come out of the background. Remember, the background they're telling us is the Dark Ages and all the brittleness. We would actually, and actually when we think about answers, they all came from being dumbed down and stupid and didn't know enough, because now we have the wheel, now we have fire, and now we're so clever, and we have the progress of civilization. We actually can be scammed into thinking that the system is it, and these are the norms of life, this is the real world, and we will give our power to that and accept it.
Well, I think the logical thing as well is, like, without us giving all our power and energy to the system collapses. So therefore, those behind the system need us and our energy. So therefore, are they going to offer us any information that sets us free?
No, they won't. They'll only give us information of our past that tells us that we were slaves and that we're still slaves. It may not be the used word slaves, but they'll always give you the images that there were kings and queens, that there were emperors and caesars and rulers, and all of us were all part of conquered whatever, ruled by a few. And because we're so familiarized with all this kind of history going back through all the books, we accept the tiny few, the kings and the queens, the presidents, the etc., to rule us today.
Well, it's because we feel helpless to do it ourselves, because it all seems such a big problem and people are silly and don't take responsibility, so we've got to have someone to do that for us.
We're uprooted from the real world. We don't know who we are anymore. And over here we turn around, it's only what they're telling, because they control all the media. They control all the information highways. Everything coming at us in every possible direction is controlled by them. It's only tiny bits and pieces, like people like us and others who are waking up, who are able to use this their technologies and stuff to try and get a message out. But it's a real battle, because how many people can you reach quickly enough to help them wake up, to take responsibility for their lives? Again, if you watch part one to part four of The Dream of Life, we cover a lot of the ground about responsibility and do no harm. this video, this one we created today, was to give you some idea of the kind of methods, the psychological terrorist attacks through hypnotic suggestion that force us to go under spells. And maybe we should do another video about the sounds. I know we mentioned this before, like the word scion, science. Now that is threatening, because it's a snake. Yeah, it's going to come to asphyxiate you. It's a danger.
Make that sort of noise.
Yeah. So when you're going scion and science, and there's another thing going on here. So we'd like to explore this in another video and discuss the imagery, because it's the symbolism of that imagery that forces under spells. And so what about that? We'll do that maybe tomorrow. In a few days we'll talk about spells. I hope that we've given you some sense that it's, don't trust what the system's telling you. Use your brain. Go to nature and get the information directly through direct perception of things. Look at the information you're thinking and see if there's a life form that embodies that information. Because if it doesn't, it's not part of the real world. And so its purpose has nothing to do with the dream of life. It has another purpose. And that purpose is to hijack you, keep you dumbed down and stupid, keep you disconnected and keep you in a hazy situation. So
keep you being a slave.
So you can be ruled by those, because you keep giving your power away, because the belief systems of all this intellectual property that has no basis in the real world is for that very reason, so we can be ruled by others. It's all about power and control. It always has been. And it's always, when you strip back this stuff, you keep finding a tiny few there who've got the power, who are the force. Goodbye to the force.
And goodbye from us.
And goodbye from us. Bye-bye.